can start by your past in as a militant, because you were 18, I guess, in 68, age 17, maybe perhaps even younger. And you were obviously already very politicized. You were in Communist Party briefly. And can you talk a little bit about how you got politicized? We discussed your father earlier, if you could maybe tell us a little bit more about it, because it's quite unusual, I mean, maybe more nowadays, to be politicized at such a young age.
Sur la politisation dans ma famille, il se trouve que depuis tout le temps, il y a en France, c'est séparé en deux, c'est-à-dire ceux qui sont de gauche et ceux qui sont de droite, ceux qui sont croyants et ceux qui sont athées. Depuis la Révolution française, il y a cette coupure entre la droite, la gauche, et dans les familles, on discute tout le temps. Et nous, mon enfance a été bercée, enfin bercée c'est entre guillemets, par la guerre d'Algérie. Donc une guerre épouvantable où il y avait les jeunes de 20 ans, 19 ans, devaient faire 3 ans de service et aller dans un pays pour lutter contre l'indépendance de ce pays. Donc ça a donné lieu à la torture, aux manifestations en France et aux groupes d'opposition qui soutenaient les combattants dont faisait partie mon père. Donc chez moi, on entendait parler dans les années 60, 61, 62, tout le temps de politique. J'avais 10 ans et bien sûr que c'était un très très politisé. Tous les déjeuners, tous les dîners, tous les amis qui passaient et toute l'organisation clandestine pour aider les Algériens.
My family's history is really imbued with this right from the start, because it's always been split. We've had part of the family that's always been to the right, part of it that's always been left-leaning, so those who are always believers, those who are always atheists. And this is something that has been true of our family since the revolution, and perhaps even before that. And when I was very young, and still in the cradle, it was the Algerian War that was very important, and it was, excuse me, it was something that was present at all the time in our household. The discussions were at every meal, lunch, dinner, all the time, and we were very closely following everything that happened. You know that during this war, and we're talking about 1960, 61, or 62, during this time, torture became a main issue, and there were many, many discussions about that in my household. And I was only about 10 years old when this was going on, so even at that early age, it was the politics at that point in Algeria that was the main topic. Excuse me.
Sorry. And which actually leads me to my second question is what I was quite struck about in the film is really early on. I think that what brings you together with the students is really the Vietnam War, which is a war that US waged in Vietnam. So if you maybe talk about this a little bit, because I guess possibly you would think that what brings people together is an issue that directly matters to French people, but it seems like the war in Vietnam was an important struggle, an important movement.
Pour le je viens d'expliquer ce qu'était la, quand on était très jeune, l'idée de l'indépendance de l'Algérie. Et bien sûr que quand on dit ça en France, c'est forcément aussi l'Indochine. Et après l'Indochine, il y a ce qu'on a appelé la guerre du Vietnam. C'est au Vietnam, en fait, quand on parle de la guerre d'Indochine. Donc c'est quelque chose, déjà, dont on avait entendu parler. Mais pour nous, pour les lycéens, il va y avoir, ça va être mis en place par, au niveau mondial, des comités Vietnam national, par Bertrand Russell, pour les tribunaux contre les crimes contre l'humanité. Il va y avoir les comités, les CVN, comité Vietnam national. Et très rapidement, les lycéens, nous, par lycée, dans tous les lycées, on va faire des comités Vietnam lycéens, des CVL. Et c'est là où on va faire tout notre apprentissage sur prendre la parole, organiser des réunions, convaincre. Notre apprentissage va se faire sur l'idée de la libération
pour la libération d'un peuple, pour l'indépendance d'un peuple. Et donc, on va apprendre la politique, apprendre à être, à faire des prises de parole, à distribuer des tracts, et puis on va avoir des bagarres quasiment tous les trois jours devant les lycées pour distribuer nos tracts contre l'extrême droite. Donc c'est là que va se faire l'apprentissage. C'est avec la guerre du Vietnam et les informations qu'on avait à l'époque sur la guerre du Vietnam.
It was actually the war in Vietnam where we did our apprenticeship as militants, because I mentioned the war in Algeria and the whole idea of independence for a people, which was something that was very important for us in France, but that also in France meant Indochina and then the war in Vietnam, which was the successor to the war in Indochina. And we had heard this spoken of, and it became something that was actually a national or international movement where you had national committees on Vietnam. And this was all over the world. And what happened was that it came down to the high school level so that while you had the national committees, you also had high schools and individual high schools, they would have their own committee for Vietnam. And these were the committees where we really cut our teeth. This is where we learned to speak in public, where we learned to convince people, where we learned to organize meetings, where we learned to pretty much do everything. It was our apprenticeship. And it was because we were all taken with this idea of the importance of the liberation and independence of a people. And so, you know, we were there, we were speaking, we were, every 3 days we'd be involved in some sort of a fight outside the school with the extreme right because we were out there distributing tracts. And so it was something that was very important part in our militant education.
Let's open it up for questions. I want to make sure that people get a chance to ask a question. There's someone right here. If you can raise your hand and I'll identify you, and there are microphones on the aisle that we can bring to you.
Hello, my name is John. I would like to ask how he saw the differences and similarities between the French movement and the American movement, what his context might have been with American radicals at the same time, or how he saw them from a distance, and what he approved or maybe did not approve of what the American movements were doing, radical movements. And I'd also like to ask, I know it's a big question, but how he thinks that movements like 1968 compared to modern movements like, say, Occupy Wall Street.
Sur la première question, on était très au courant par le fait que les organisations étudiantes, l'UNEF et les organisations étudiantes dans les autres facultés, partout, en Allemagne, au Japon, il y avait des contacts avec les organisations étudiantes. Il y avait des contacts avec les organisations communistes qui menaient un combat international pour la paix au Vietnam. C'est-à-dire qu'il y avait des tas de mouvements pacifistes pour la paix au Vietnam qui faisaient des contacts avec toutes les organisations. Et puis, nous, précisément, comme j'étais militant trotskiste, on était membre de la 4e internationale et on était très, très au courant de ce qui se passait dans chaque pays, c'est-à-dire de comment ça se radicalisait dans tous les pays et en Europe. C'est-à-dire qu'on participait aux manifestations à Berlin en 67, en Italie en 68, avant mai 68. Donc il y avait un contact très très précis avec les différents, comment fonctionnaient les différents mouvements dans les différents pays en Amérique, bien sûr, on était au courant, et en Europe. On essayait d'avancer ensemble. Pourquoi ? Parce qu'on n'était pas pacifistes, nous. On était pour la victoire du FLN. Et c'est ça qui fait toute la différence. Et c'est ça qui va faire les groupes d'extrême gauche et les groupes gauchistes. Il y a le PC et le Parti communiste est pour la paix au Vietnam, et nous, on n'est pas pour la paix. On est pour la victoire, c'est-à-dire on est pour la guerre jusqu'à la victoire. Et c'est ça qui va être la fracture entre ce qu'on appelle les radicaux et les autres mouvements.
We were very much aware of what was going on in a lot of the student organizations all over the world, because we knew what was going on. We were in UNEF, and there were parallel organizations at the same time in Germany and Japan. We had contacts with them, and those also had contacts with other countries. So we really pretty much knew what was going on throughout. We also knew what was going on in a lot of the organizations that were trying to promote peace in Vietnam, those organizations that were more pacifist in their approach. I myself was part of the Fourth International, and as a Trotskyist, we were opposed to the whole idea of peace in Vietnam. What we wanted to have was war up until the war would decide what the outcome would be. But we were very much part of an international movement. We were present in 67 in student demonstrations in Germany, in 68 in Italy before May. Of 68 in France, and we had specific contacts throughout Europe and also in the United States. So what we were really trying to do was to advance our particular program, which was the victory of the FLN, and that this victory would come as a result of the end of the war. We were not of the pacifist way of thinking, which was the French Communist Party's way of thinking, and this is really what was at the heart of the division between the radicals and the PC in France at the time.
Et le meilleur exemple, c'est qu'on citait sans arrêt Che Guevara avec l'appel de l'OLAS, l'organisation latino-américaine, où il avait fait un très grand discours où le mot d'ordre que se répétait toute la jeunesse à travers le monde, c'est créer 1, 2, 3 Vietnam. C'est-à-dire que non seulement il y avait un front au Vietnam, mais il fallait qu'on crée d'autres fronts à Cuba, en Amérique latine, en Indonésie, partout. Il fallait déclencher des fronts et des luttes armées pour arriver à changer le monde et à battre l'impérialisme américain. Donc au nom de 1, 2, 3 Vietnam, ça c'est 66-67, on était effectivement sur une position extrêmement radicale. Révolutionnaire.
And we also were really in a very, we really had a very radical and revolutionary perspective and position. And we were motivated, for example, Che Guevara, who gave a very famous speech in which he called upon Latin America to become involved in revolution. We saw this and as organizations that were, pardon, looking for these kinds of struggles, not just in Vietnam, but on all fronts, for example, in Cuba, in Latin America, in Indonesia, so that one by one they would come, one, two, three. And this armed struggle is what we were really looking to promote.
Sur la deuxième question, you asked for a second question. Sur la deuxième question, par rapport à est-ce qu'on peut recommencer 68 maintenant? Je considère que déjà nous, en 68, on répétait l'idée de faire une révolution de type bolchevique, c'est-à-dire une grève générale. La grève générale doit devenir insurrectionnelle. Cette insurrection met en place des soviets ou des comités d'ouvriers autogestionnaires qui doivent déboucher sur la dictature du prolétariat et la prise du pouvoir. C'est-à-dire, c'était ça le modèle, c'était ça qu'on voulait faire, refaire en France. On était déjà en retard de 50 ans. Donc si vous me demandez maintenant, un siècle plus tard, si on est prêt et encore prêt à faire la révolution de 17 en France, je vous dis franchement, carrément, non, absolument non. 68 a réussi parce qu'ils ne nous ont pas écoutés, ils ont dépassé les organisations d'extrême gauche. Ils ont fait un mouvement qui était contre la France du 19e siècle, contre une France de l'ordre moral, verticale, mais en aucun cas un mouvement de type révolutionnaire comme nous on l'espérait, mais on était un tout petit noyau.
And to answer your second question, which was really comparing what happened in 1968 and the possibility of it happening now, what we were doing in 1968 was not new. What we were doing was repeating what had taken place in 1917 with the Bolshevik Revolution. And our model in making revolution was pretty much how the Soviets had accomplished it in 1917, which was first it would come from a general strike. After the general strike, there would be insurrection. These insurrections would ultimately lead to the setting up of workers' committees, which were the Soviets in the Soviet Union. And this ultimately would lead to the revolution, which would put in place the rule of the proletariat at that time. This was the model that we were looking at. So already in 1968, this was a model that was over 50 years old for us. And what was happening in France at that time, and which distinguished us from a lot of the other left movements, was that what they were trying to do was to really overturn the France that we had that was a vestige of the 19th century France that we knew. They were not looking to this kind of revolution or to have this kind of revolution the way we particularly were. So I don't think now, with the perspective of looking back at 100 years to 1917, that this is something that would ever be accomplished in France.
We have a question towards the back. Right, you. Right here, with the raised hand, yeah, okay. With the glasses.
Alors, dans les films que vous aviez faits et dans ce film-là, je voulais savoir qui étaient vos influences artistiques.
The question is, in this film and other films that you've made, what were your artistic influences?
Sur ce premier film, il est fait en état d'urgence absolue pour protéger l'histoire ou raconter l'histoire avec Michel. Et il va faire état de toute une série d'influences, mais il n'y a pas de modèle pour moi pour mourir à 30 ans. Et après, les autres films vont se faire par rapport à ce film-là. C'est-à-dire par rapport à mourir à 30 ans. Donc, pareil, j'ai pas de référence, il n'y a pas d'exemple pour moi d'un film à suivre ou d'un maître qui m'aurait ou je voudrais répéter. Par contre, j'ai toujours fonctionné par les négatives, c'est-à-dire, je le dis, dans mourir à 30 ans, je ne supporte pas les films où on a un discours et après on va filmer pour illustrer ce discours. C'est-à-dire, je ne supporte pas les films politiques et les films de propagande. Je ne supporte pas Ken Loach, par exemple.
This film was my first film and it was made pretty much under emergency conditions because it was very important to document at the time what had happened to Michel. And to tell the story of what had happened with him. I think that perhaps looking at my films, you can say that there may have been a number of influences, but there was no specific model that I was following when I made that film. And with subsequent films that I made, I often made them using my own first film as a model. So I pretty much did not have external references or any, you know, master director that I wanted to reference or to copy. And so, but one of the things in my career that I've always tried to do is I've always tried to work almost in a negative, from a negative perspective, which is one of the things I don't like is the film that has a speech that has a particular agenda that it wants to promote, And so it begins with that, and then the film is made to support that message that's trying to be promoted, whether it be a propaganda film or whether it be a theatrical film that has that kind of approach. I don't like this, and this, in fact, is one of the reasons why I don't particularly like the films of Ken Loach.
Comme assistant, j'ai été l'assistant de Chantal Akerman, et la liberté qu'elle avait anticonformiste a sûrement eu une influence. Après, j'ai travaillé avec Godard, et c'est sûr que la façon dont il n'a jamais trouvé, il a toujours cherché, mais jamais trouvé, mais continuellement cherché, a eu une influence, forcément. Et j'ai travaillé, j'ai eu beaucoup d'admiration avec Test de Roman Polanski, où c'est un incroyable technicien. Et ma formation est une formation d'opérateur, de technicien. Donc, ce mélange-là, d'adorer le cadre, d'adorer la technique, de ne pas trouver, de se poser sans arrêt des questions et de jamais essayer de séduire le public, je pense à Chantal Akerman ou à Godard, c'est ça qui fait aussi ma formation.
On the other hand, I worked as assistant to Chantal Akerman, and I was very much impressed by her whole anti-conformist approach to freedom and liberty in filmmaking. So this was someone who was very important. I also worked as an assistant with Godard, and here again, Godard has been on a search for his whole career, always looking for that freedom in what he's doing, and he still is. And so this also, I think, was something that influenced me. Finally, I think my own training was really as a technician on the technical side of filmmaking, as a cameraman. And one of the films that I have great admiration for is Tess by Roman Polanski, because of the technical quality of that as a film. So the whole idea of the technical aspect of framing, everything that's involved on the technical side, is also something that really interests me. I'm never out to the way Godard and Chantal Akerman as well. Like them, I'm never out to make a film simply so that I can please an audience.
There's a question right in the front.
My name is Rao, I'm from India. We used the Sorbonne student movement model in 82-83 at the Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi. So I have some familiarity. We were told, that's a comment, we were told the Communist Party of France did not support student movement because students are not a working class, therefore they're not a proletariat. I know you may be Trotskyite, but how far is that true, or is it something behind the scenes rather than this polemic excuse? I mean, I was told the real reason, the thing was that time there's a lot of administrative rules and students were up against it and there was a lot of restrictions. That's how the whole unrest grew up. I have a lot of questions, but I'll ask only one more question. The Kohan Benditi, he fled Paris and went and joined the Green Party. And became the president of the Green Party or whatever he is in Europe. He still continues there. Could Michel could have done something similar like that? Thank you.
Est-ce que c'est ça?
Je vais commencer par la troisième question. Est-ce que Michel aurait pu adhérer comme Cohn-Bendit à l'idée de l'écologie s'il avait survécu? Alors là, c'est une question impossible. Je ne peux pas répondre. Très peu d'amis, de copains, de militants sont devenus écologistes. On avait une formation, on est une formation productiviste, marxiste. C'est pas nous qui sommes à l'avant-garde sur l'écologie. À l'époque, en 68, on se posait aucun problème sur le nucléaire, aucun problème sur le climat. On était pour le progrès, et le progrès, c'était le progrès pour les masses. Donc, tout était bon. Vous augmentez la production. On était productiviste et progressiste, ce qui veut tout dire. Donc, anti-écologiste à l'époque, vraiment comme formation.
I'm going to answer your last question first, which was would Michel have followed a kind of path that Cohn-Bendit did, becoming a green and becoming someone who was involved in the ecology movement. And it's something that's simply impossible to know and to say. I don't really know. I know that there are very few militants of my group, my generation, who became involved in ecology because it just simply wasn't the issue for us. We were trained as Marxists, we were trained as productivists, and we were progressive. We saw all advances in society as being progressive, and progressive in a way that would ultimately benefit the proletariat. So things like, you know, the environment and climate change and nuclear reactors and nuclear power were not issues for us because we saw all of those as progress that would ultimately be for the benefit of the proletariat. So I think that really is what distinguished us.
Sur la première et deuxième question, en fait, je l'ai dit un peu en tout début. Le Parti communiste était pour la paix au Vietnam. Et tous les groupes d'extrême gauche considéraient que c'était des traîtres, qu'ils abandonnaient l'idée de la révolution. Et que nous, ce qu'on voulait faire, c'est ce que ne faisait plus le Parti communiste. Il était accusé d'être révisionniste par les maoïstes ou d'être traître comme stalinien par les trotskistes, par nous. Donc, dans tous les cas de figure, le Parti communiste était le parti à abattre, à changer. Et donc, c'était notre ennemi principal, de changer le Parti communiste. On pensait que le Parti communiste, c'est ce qui bloquait toute possibilité révolutionnaire. Et donc, il nous haïssait à hauteur de ce combat-là. Jamais. Et donc, il nous accusait de tout, et nous, on les accusait de tout. Il y avait une lutte importante, très importante, entre qui allait de nouveau avoir une perspective révolutionnaire.
And in answer to the first your comment and your first question, at the time, as I mentioned earlier, the French Communist Party was interested in peace in Vietnam, and all of the groups that were of the more extreme left were not, and so this really put us on opposite sides, and they in fact did become pretty much our primary enemy in the political situation. And we saw them as something that needed to be defeated because they were blocking change. The Communist Party as it stood by supporting this peace in Vietnam is not a communist party that would ultimately lead to a revolution for the proletariat. And so they were blocking things that needed to happen. And so they became our, we hated them, they were our enemy much as we were theirs. And this was a very important struggle at the time over who really would be in the leadership of the revolution.
We have time for one or two more questions. So let's take one in the back over there.
Hi, my name is Larry, and I'm wondering, let me make sure I have my facts straight. You recently have done a film with Daniel Cohn-Bendit, is that correct? Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes, okay. That's correct.
So whatever journey Michel might have taken, this is a follow-up from the Indian gentleman down in the front, whatever path we'll never know Michel may have taken, but your path is quite different because you've moved from that, it would seem to me, given what I understand the film to be about, and who Daniel Cohn-Bendit has become, he's a very different character than the Danny the Red we knew from 68. He's become involved in the issues of capitalist societies, and he's become a reformist on a large scale. So I'm wondering, describe to us a little bit your political journey from a film about a friend who was highly radical and very leftist and, very leftist, leave it at that, and now making a film about a guy who is looking back at 68 and seeing the impact of it in a much different light than we saw it then.
Sur Cohn-Bendit et les groupes auxquels j'appartenais, les groupes gauchistes, on était en désaccord complet en mai 68. Ils disaient, ce n'est pas une révolution, c'est une révolte culturelle. Ils avaient l'analyse que c'était pas du tout une révolution de type marxiste, qu'on n'était pas en train de refaire 1917, qu'on se trompait tous, qu'on rêvait tous à ça, mais qu'on se trompait. Et donc, c'était un ennemi à l'époque. Après, dans les années 73-74, par la façon dont on répétait toujours les mêmes discours, par la façon dont ça n'avançait pas, j'ai commencé à me poser des questions et à lire et à discuter et à me rapprocher de la façon dont ils réfléchissaient en Allemagne avec les Verts et commencer à... Et moi, j'ai énormément changé. Cohn-Bendit n'a pas changé. Il a toujours pensé la même chose. Il était contre les groupes gauchistes, contre les groupes communistes, contre le totalitarisme. Il a toujours dit c'est une révolte, c'est pas une révolution. Moi, je pensais que c'était une révolution qu'il fallait recommencer, que c'était une répétition. Donc moi, je me suis énormément trompé et j'ai changé. Je suis devenu réformiste et maintenant je suis d'accord avec Cohn-Bendit et c'est l'objet du film qu'on a fait, le dernier film qu'on a fait. Moi, effectivement, j'ai vraiment, vraiment changé entre le personnage qu'on voit dans le film et ce que je pense maintenant, enfin ce que j'ai pensé à partir de 75, les années 75, il y a un énorme changement. Je ne suis plus du tout révolutionnaire.
I think that the Daniel Cohn-Bendit that you see in the film, he was actually somebody who was not supportive of the idea of revolution. He was totally against us because his idea was that what was happening and what needed to happen was not a revolution, but was really a revolt. More of a cultural revolt, not the kind of political revolution that we in the extreme left radical parties were trying to have come about. So he was not looking to see 1917 repeated. This was something that he was totally against. And so, in effect, he was our enemy at the time. And I think that his move in Germany, ultimately into the Green Party, is really not so different from what he believed back in the time period you're seeing in the film. His ideas have not really changed that much over the course of time. However, my ideas have changed a great deal. My ideas from what you see in the film have changed radically, pardon the word, I have changed a great deal since then because what I saw by 1973, 1974, was that the kind of revolution that we were hoping to see happen was not going to happen. And I did a great deal of reading. I did a lot of researching and soul searching. And I realized that this idea of repeating the Bolshevik Revolution of 1917 was a mistaken idea, that it was not going to happen. And so gradually over time, really, say from about 1975, my ideas really changed quite a lot to the point where I became much more of a reformist and now agree with many of the things that Daniel Cohn-Bendit believes in. So the major change was mine.
And that's why you made the film together, right? Let's have one more question. Young lady right here. The microphone is gonna get to you in a second.
Thank you. So given your progression over the years in terms of your worldview, what do you think the role is in our modern day world in the fight against the recent waves of right movements that have been growing politically across Europe and in the first world in general? What do you think the role is of violence, and what do you think the role is of art in terms of pushing back in a leftist way?
Sur ce qui se passe en Europe, c'est une catastrophe dont la France est la première responsable en votant non à la Constitution européenne en 2005. Quand on a fait croire qu'il y avait un vote de gauche contre l'Europe, ça a été la plus grande erreur. Il n'y a jamais eu de vote non de gauche, ça a toujours été un vote non de la droite extrême, ou de la droite. Ils ont dit que c'était un nom de gauche, mais les gens qui ont voté en France à 54% contre l'Europe ont cassé en 2005 l'idée de l'Europe. Après, ça a été, depuis, c'est très très compliqué. Donc déjà, c'est le premier point.
As far as the situation in Europe is concerned, the current situation, it's a catastrophe. And I think that France is the country that is primarily responsible for helping to bring this catastrophe about. And this has to do with the fact that in 2005, the French voted against the Constitution for Europe. And by doing so, this really opened the way for some of these extreme right groups to come in.
L'idée de l'Europe, des États-Unis de l'Europe, est une idée, une utopie concrète la plus incroyable qu'on peut proposer en ce moment aux jeunes partout en Europe. Un contrat, le premier contrat, c'est antifasciste, le deuxième, c'est antitotalitaire, anticommuniste, antistalinien, et le troisième, anticolonialiste. C'est pour ça que ça s'est fait, l'Europe. Et de pas penser que l'Europe est notre avenir, de revenir à des frontières, à des pays souverains ou des États-nations, est un incroyable recul qui nous emmène, comme vous le dites, sur des votes nationalistes, d'extrême droite, xénophobes, racistes. Une Europe qu'on croyait ou on espérait avoir dépassée. On est en train de régresser. La catastrophe de 2005 est en train de produire ses répliques tout le temps, dans cette période-là.
And I think also, if you think about it, this whole idea that was proposed in the Constitution of 2005 was really a kind of United States of Europe, which is an incredibly utopian idea. And it's an idea that's based on being anti-fascist, being anti-totalitarian, and being anti-authoritarian. And it was something that would have appealed to younger people. But by rejecting this constitution and really retaining the whole idea of sovereign countries with borders, in fact, this was not progress, but it was regression. It was going back to individual countries with borders to keep people in or to keep people out. And it's this that year after year has led to an increase in the more right-wing, extreme right-wing groups.
On peut comparer pour nous, pour ici ce soir, en disant ce qui s'est passé en 2005 pour l'Europe, pour le monde, le refus de Trump de la COP21, c'est la même chose. C'est-à-dire à partir de ce refus des États-Unis d'aller dans la COP21 sur le climat, ça va être un recul qui va tout va se déliter, tout va s'abîmer à partir de cette décision. Il y a des moments comme ça dans l'histoire où on peut dire une date et un moment. Après, on retrouvera à partir de quel moment ça a commencé à se déliter, à se désagréger, à devenir régressif, à aller en arrière. Ben, il y a un immense moment, c'est 2005, la France, par rapport à l'Europe, et il y a un immense moment au monde, c'est le refus de Trump de considérer l'intérêt général ou l'intérêt commun de toute la planète, de dire qu'il était contre l'accord du COP21. Ça va arrêter un mouvement. Ce n'est pas la fin du monde, mais ça arrête quelque chose. Ça arrête cette idée du monde commun, cette idée de la planète commune, cette idée des États-Unis du monde. Ça arrête ça, dans l'idée.
And I think just as the vote by the French in 2005 was really a key moment, I think another key moment, as we're going to look back on it, will most likely be Donald Trump pulling the U.S. out of the climate agreement. Because here you have an agreement that was something that was uniting not just Europe, but the whole planet with a common cause, with a common purpose. And to simply pull out of this is much the same way that when the French voted the Constitution down in 2005. It's not an advance, it's a step back, it's a regression. And I think at some point we're going to look at this and we're going to say, what are the key moments when things really began to change and really began to disintegrate? And I think that this pulling out from the climate agreement by Trump is going to be one of those moments, because the whole idea of something that we had in common with all other countries on the planet has been destroyed.
Well, thank you so much, Romain. Thank you. We We have a drink upstairs, and Romain will be joining us. So if you want to stick around and ask questions, you're welcome to join us.